warm welcome to you, and thank you very much for being part of the program again today. My name is Dakwo Aruajue. The screening continues today at the Senate after a recess yesterday. So hopefully most of the ministerial nominees might be screened today. And if Rotimi Amaechi will be screened today, that's a $1 million question. We'll wait, only time will tell. So in the meantime, we will be coming to Lagos, but we will definitely go to Abuja and join the live transmission later during the course of this program. But in the meantime, we will come to Lagos. And when we say come to Lagos, we will need to talk about these newly appointed commissioners of the Governor Ambode's ESCO. I'm talking about Governor Ambode's ESCO. We have 23 commissioners and 14 advisors. So today we'll try and set agenda for them. We'll look at the challenges before these ESCOs and try and proffer solutions to some areas that we think that needs attention ASAP, talking about as soon as possible. And to help us do this discussion this morning, I have Nelson Ekojibi, is a rights activist. Thank you very much, Nelson.
Good morning. Thank you for having me on your program.
And also I have Mojeed Jamiu. He is a journalist. Thank you, Mojeed.
Good morning, Dapo, and good morning, viewers at home.
Thank you, Mojeed. Yeah, in my intro, I said 23 commissioners. I'm talking to you now. Yeah. 23 commissioners and 14 advisors were assigned portfolios of recent some days ago. And do you think these people, with the caliber of these people, they will take Lagos to the place that we Lagosians think it should be taken?
I think I'll start by saying that Lagosians should count themselves lucky in the sense that there has been continuity. Since from 1999 till date, Ashua Dubola met Tinubu, started building the foundation, and the baton of leadership was handed over to Rajiv Fashola, BRF, who is now, of course, a minister designate. And they said from the visioner to the actualizer, and to continuity, to the consolidator in Akinwumi Ambode. And you see, in a situation we find ourselves, we can call this austere times, as in austerity times in Nigeria. And Lagos is not an exception, despite the fact that there's so much IGR in Lagos. Lagos is the fourth largest economy in Africa, so to say. After Nigeria, you pick South Africa, and I think either Kenya or Zimbabwe, then it is Lagos as a state in terms of the GDP. So the task is enormous. But then, like I said, Lagosians are quite lucky in terms of succession. There is a succession plan for Lagos. It's not as if another government from another party will come and scatter whatever has been grant. And also, for the very first time, Lagos will be in the mainstream, as in we have, Lagos is being controlled by the same party
at
both the state and the federal level. So all this will work together. But then that's not to say that there are no challenges. But from the people that have been selected by Ambode, the 23 commissioners and I think the 14 special advisors. You see that it's a blend of those who have worked under Tinubu, those who have worked under Fashola, and some new eggheads. Some new kids in the block.
Because experience really, like
Jide Idris, and he was commissioner for health for 8 years.
Okay.
And you can see the transformation in the health sector, though we are not yet there.
And he was a special advisor for eight years also.
Yeah, and not so a special advisor.
We'll definitely look at each of these commissioners definitely soon. During the swearing in, Governor Ambode said Lagos must fulfill its potentials. And the potentials of Lagos, it's a very big one. Do you think these people will help Ambode to fulfill this potential?
Well, to take a cue from where he mentioned, I think I want to congratulate ourselves as Lagosians that we have been very, very lucky to have this type of leadership in the state that has, started with the administration of Ashwaji, like he rightly said, up to the Governor Okumambodi, and you and I know very well that even before the appointment of these men and women of caliber, the man had already hit the ground running. And we can see that he has touched almost all facets of the economy of the state. But be that as it may, we are very optimistic that the team he has assembled are very, very capable hands that can take the state to greater heights, because we have seen people who are professionals in their various fields. Is it in the area of medicine, like you have just mentioned, you mentioned Dr. Jide Idris. Is it in the area of law? You see, he has assembled a crack team of professionals and eggheads, and we're very, very optimistic that
they will deliver
despite the challenges that they will deliver. But that is not to say that we'll go to sleep, because like they usually say, Iteshua Jueku, that is our main priority.
Okay. We need to take most of his ministries one by one. They're very, very important. All of them are important, but we need to take some champion ones. And let's go to Home Affairs. Abdul Hakim Abdul Latif is in charge of Home Affairs. I know Home Affairs is in charge as the body of the security, the local security also. And of recent, people will be saying that there have been pockets of violence in Lagos, and there have been robberies, which the waterways has been a source for easier robberies in Lagos. Do you want to talk about that and challenges before Mr. Abdul Latif?
Yeah, no, Abdul Latif, Abdul Hakim, I mean, he has a pedigree. He served in the State House of Assembly, and he has been around, so he knows the terrain quite very well. But then for Home Affairs, I mean, it's unlike what obtains at the federal level, where you have a Ministry of Internal Affairs who handles issues of internal security. And then at the state level, it's the governor that is the chief security officer of the state. And he handles, they have this security council meeting there, where all the garrison commanders, the commissioner of police, RRS, commander, all the
DSS,
SSS, the RANA now, DSS, then the Navy, the Army, and we have all those formations. So they all meet, even including the Civil Defense Corps. So they all meet and chat away. And if you should recall, one of the first things that Governor Akinwumabodi did when he assumed office was to summon a meeting, and he was able to realize the critical need of policing a state like Lagos, that has about 20 million population now. And invited the private sector, where for the very first time about 1 billion was pulled together. And I think he mentioned at the first town hall meeting at Abeson that some of these funds should be channeled towards providing security for the people of Lagos in terms of equipping the police, and also ensuring that they have motorable vehicles. Are top of the range in terms of gadgets and what have you, and also ensuring that the police force are properly mobilized. And if you recall, most of the robberies that have been occurring in Lagos, there have been a lead. They have been getting a wind of. There have been arrests, and I think those who are involved in the killing of the MD of the Lekki concessional son, Taju Dizu. Tunde Dizu. I think some of them have been apprehended.
When you say some of them, even of recent, the people that were arrested, the people of that society, or the people of the community. Yeah. They've come forth to say
they're pointing akin to fingers at the police.
Shot the MD.
Well, I think probably when they get to court, that will be sorted out.
And again, you made mention of the fact that some of the people that were part of these robberies were caught. Yeah. At the end of the day, when they catch these people, they've caught some people. They said they're going to sue the Lagos State Government, the police, because they were not even part.
No, that they were not part of the robbery. Some of them said they were not charged to court on time. I mean, mm-hmm. the armed robbers are now suing the police and the Lagos State Government. You see, the administration of criminal justice is also very key. And with Kazim Adeniji, I mean, who is a seasoned lawyer as the Attorney General of and Commissioner for Justice in Lagos, I want to believe he will do something about
it. Yeah, Mujida, I'll come straight to you because there are a lot of questions about this Lagos Security Trust Fund also. What is happening to the trust fund? Because we used to have like boats and everything. So what's happening? Even helicopters to even pursue all these criminals. Yeah. But let me quickly come to this because there was an allegation about a columnist wrote that the new IG has taken the operational officers away from Lagos, the people that really fight the war against the crime from Lagos. Now we have administrative officers left. So what do you have to say to that, Nelson?
Well, I think that is still an allegation in the public sphere. But the truth of the matter is that we will continue to have security challenges in our crime unless and until we restructure the country's political system. What do I mean by this? You see, we are running a system in which the person who wears the shoe is not the one feeling the pinch. Ordinarily, in decent crimes, policing is localized because of the fact that a policeman can only recover properties if he's able to, but he cannot recover a lost life. Mm. And you and I know very well that there's no substitute for life. Policing is not about going after criminals after the incident must have occurred. It is about preempting, it is about information gathering, so that incident will not occur. That is why in decent crimes, you see people in the neighborhood themselves are their own security. I think I've been here on this station and I gave a vivid illustration of what happened in my area where I live, where some women, who had shops on the streets, saw a group of four young boys, roughly dressed, going smoking, and they drew the attention of the CDA to it. Because I live there, my wife is there, my children lives there, my neighbors, we are like families, we know ourselves in and out. Because you don't know who the untoward incident could happen to. If you tell me as I'm sitting down here now, that, God forbid, that there's a bomb blast in my locality, I'll be the first person to run out of this station because I know one way or the other, I might be affected. Mm. But unfortunately, we have a security system in which somebody providing security for the people in Alakpere, where this your station is, is somebody who does not even know the terrain, who has no stake in the essence of livelihood of the people here.
So you're saying everybody should be a stakeholder in all this?
Yes.
But what about the primary responsibility of the people themselves?
What I'm telling you is that unless and until it is restructured in such a way that you who wear the shoe must be the one feeling the pinch, so that when security lapses occur, you know that if I'm not the direct victim, I could be an indirect victim.
Okay.
It will make you take it more seriously than we have before.
But the question I said I was going to ask you, that Lagos Trust Fund, because you remember, I think it was headed by Atowori then. We had a lot of monies gathered to secure Lagos. I thought we had helicopters, we had a gunboat. What happened? Yeah. And why is it that these gunboats are not positioned where they should be? So these armed robbers or that use the waterways, they will know, okay, we cannot outrun these people. That it has happened like 3 or 4 times. Why are we not doing the preventive? Why do we have to arrest later? Why don't we just stay there so this crime will not happen?
Our efforts at the response rate, I would say, is a bit slow. But we should know that the trust for the Security Trust Fund is partly driven by the private sector. I mean, the private sector contributes into it.
Yes.
Coordinated by the Lagos State Government. I mean, but then I think the governor even made mention of more helicopters to be purchased in addition to the five that is on that.
But the five that we have,
yes,
are they being used?
No, yeah, of course they are using them. I mean, once in a while you see helicopters and some of these choppers hovering around the city. But you see, Lagos is a very, very sophisticated community, and I mean, you see the. We have vast land. I mean, it's choked land mass. Mm. I mean, surrounded by water. So, even if you have 200 gunboats, I mean, the most of Lagos is on water, and there are so many from Ikorodu to Ekpe, Lekki, even as
Badagry,
and even Okota. The robberies and the abduction in Okota, Festac and Okota. Mm. I mean, the escape route was through the riverland area. So, I mean, but I think there's a holistic approach that is being put together now to ensure that these waterways are properly manned. I mean, they are getting more. I mean, the Navy is, I think the Security Trust Fund is getting the Navy much more involved now. You know, there was a time the federal government ceded the control of the waterways to some private sector, I mean, headed by Tom Polo. So the naval officers, I mean, the Navy actually pulled out. So, and you have a situation in Lagos where the federal government controls the inland waterways.
Mm.
So the state government cannot actually police what is happening on the waterways. So, and you have some federal roads that just in the same way you have some federal roads that the Lagos state government took it upon itself during the last two administrations of Tinubu and Fashola. They constructed, repaired these roads. 57 billion naira is hanging with the federal government today. It's just now that the Buhari administration is making efforts to ensure that some of these monies are refunded. All over the country, we have about 357 billion due as refund for a federal government project executed by states. So some of these issues, I mean, and you have a situation where the commissioner of police, I mean, can only listen to the governor. I mean, he takes orders from the IG.
Mm-hmm.
So if there's an instruction coming from the police, so that's why I subscribe to the issue of the need for community or state policing. I mean, with some measured,
just like Nelson suggested.
Yeah, just like Nelson suggested. Mm. Until then, so that we have a situation where the person who pays the piper will be able to dictate the tune.
Okay, we need to go to another sector entirely, and this is a very germane one, where we'll talk about traffic in Lagos. We talk about means of transportation. That's the Ministry of Transportation. And we have Mr. Ekundayo Mabiriola in charge of that sector. He was the SA on transportation, so you should know the onions, his onions, and he was also the MD, or should be the MD, LAMATA, Lagos State Transportation Agency. And what do you think should be addressed immediately? Because the mode of transportation, some people say, why don't we use waterways again as a major means of transportation? Why don't we? There's a whole lot to be discussed about it. And of recent, even the Lagos State House of Assembly has summoned the boss of LASMA to come before them and talk about this incessant traffic. What do you want to say to that?
Well, what I want to say is that, one, there is need for the government to really reinvigorate the people's interest in other means of transportation. I recall very well that the last administration introduced life jackets for those speedboats on the waterways, and they made it compulsory. But just like we have road accidents, we have also had accidents on the sea. But unfortunately, a lot of Nigerians don't know how to swim. So they dread, even when you put on the mere sight of the waters alone, is enough to scare away life out of some people. But presently, why we are experiencing this traffic logjam is because of the fact that the traffic agencies have not been up and doing. Don't forget.
Or they are overwhelmed.
They are not overwhelmed. They have not been up and doing. The issue of traffic management is not only the responsibility of the state. The federal government also has a responsibility there. Don't forget, we have the Motor Traffic Division of the Nigerian Police. But what you have is that if you look at the way we drive on our roads, the way we walk on our roads, you realize that we are a very, very indisciplined lot. And again,
so that's why I said they should be overwhelmed. You said they are not up and doing.
Yeah.
But when we're compounded with the way we drive,
yeah.
Do you think these people, do they need more people or do they need laws to make them strict?
There's enough laws on ground. What we need is strict enforcement and, you know, maybe continuous sensitization of our people. I'll give you a vivid example. There was a day my vehicle broke down at a T-junction. And while waiting for a towing van to come and tow my vehicle, there was a traffic warden and a policeman at that T-junction. Honestly, between you and I, within 5 minutes, I had to go to the traffic warden and ask, is this what you people go through? 97% or 99% of Nigerians driving on the roads, they don't know how to drive.
Yes, I think that's a major problem. People don't want to admit they don't know how to drive.
If a policeman is not holding a baton or a gun, even when the traffic light shows green and red, that you should stop, people will still want to go. That, I'm in a hurry, let me be the light. You wonder what sort of human beings are these? What will take you just 30 seconds to allow the other man go and the road will be free? Everybody will put.
Let me go to Mojid.
We're
still talking about the incessant traffic situation. What about if we have the traffic lights and we have cameras, walking cameras? Because I think the money for the cameras will take care. Okay, the money is for the 10 traffic officers you see at that roundabout. Sometimes you see policemen up to 10 traffic officers at one roundabout. All they are waiting for is to catch that man that ran red. Why don't we have good working cameras? And maybe in conjunction, I don't know, with another ministry, maybe the Home Office or the Home Affairs, let us have cameras and monitor people that violate traffic laws. Won't that work?
Yeah, fine. We can get cameras, but then, Nelson said, we are in a very lawless society. Just yesterday, the government, the governor's monitoring team, in charge of enforcement of traffic laws, apprehended some people plying
the BRT
lane yesterday. And you know what happened? Some of them pulled out their guns. They are men of either the state security or the police or the army. I mean, trying to fight those who are enforcing. I mean,
there are instances they were beaten up. The traffic by officers.
By officers. I mean, we've had several instances. I mean, there was this celebrated case of the former governor arresting a colonel. I mean, passing BRT lane. So there's so much indiscipline on the part of road users.
What will leave the indiscipline? What about looking for other means of transportation?
Yeah, fine. I think the Lagos rail project that is running from Badagry to the mainland, to the island, when fully completed, will carry about 800,000 passengers per day. Until Lagos, we have about 17 million people, and I think Lagos has about the highest concentration of vehicular traffic in the world, apart from China and India. But Lagos as a metropolis, everybody wants to be a big man. You have somebody who has 4 vehicles. The wife takes 1 vehicle. The driver takes some kids. The man takes another. We have a family who puts about 4 vehicles on the road. Whereas in UK, there is what we call
park and ride.
Park and ride. Just like what we are trying to do in Ojota, where you park at the toll gate
and you take
the BRT. Mm. But how many people do use that option? Everybody wants to be driven. Everybody puts their vehicles on the road. And so it's not as if, and there's a limit to which we can expand
the road.
The roads in Lagos.
So we have to talk about enlightenment also. Let's talk about these articulated vehicles. There have been issues about articulated vehicles. So the new commissioner must know how to address this issue, because even after enforcement, even after don't drive in the afternoon, drive in the night, we've been seeing even accidents of articulated vehicle immediately after these laws are put in place. And what do you have to say to that?
What I have to say to that is that, one, there is need for the state government to approach the federal government so that the state government will have a monitoring team from the transportation ministry that will be overseeing, or maybe also part of the team that will ensure that only articulated vehicles that are, you know, in quality shape, that can move on the roads. Because a situation whereby the man who controls the ports that, you know, causes all these accidents on Lagos Road, destroys the road, is sitting right there in Abuja. He's not feeling the pains of the average Lagosian.
Not feeling the pains.
So the person about 3 days ago.
Before you say that, let me let viewers know that we have the visuals at the screening. So soon we might be linking up with the screening at the Senate. Okay.
In fact, 3 days ago, I was on my way to Apapa. I got to Ijora. I was stuck. This morning, I was on my way to Apapa again. I got to Maitu. I had to make a U-turn in order to meet up with this program. That is what Lagosians are facing. That is why I was very happy when I read in the news that Senator Oluremi Tinubu is tabling a bill. The havoc that those articulated vehicles are causing on the roads, except the Lagos state government and the people of Lagos, who are the victims, are themselves part and parcel of who will ensure compliance with standards, will continue to be in this position.
And which we don't want to.
Which
be.
We don't want. And again, they raised an issue which was very, very germane, because the other time when they were insisting on enforcing the movement of articulated vehicles, they raised the issue of security. And that is very, very key.
And because it has not been addressed.
Yeah, it has not been addressed, because you see these articulated vehicles in traffic, you see some boys will climb into the driver's cabin, some will be at the tank, they want to remove the tank cover. A lot of criminal activities.
So all those should be addressed. Really.
They should be addressed.
We might not be able to delve into each of these sectors, but generally, what should Lagosians be looking at? And how soon should they be feeling the dividend of this democracy? Because they might say it's been a while that the government has been sworn in, as talking about the executive. Why is it that it's taking a long time for the commissioners to be brought forth? But now that we have the commissioners, how soon should they be expecting, talking about Lagos, how soon should they be expecting dividend of democracy?
I think the dividends are already coming, but then not without some expectations. See, Nigerians voted for change, and we are so expectant. We are almost always in a hurry. But then in a situation where you have tank farms that are taking over a civilian area, so to say, I mean, like a GR. People used to be a GRA, but now what you have there are tank farms. And what those tank farms do, it attracts trailers.
Mm.
So the whole of Apapa, I mean, it's like people are moving out of Apapa now. It has become, so there's a need for government to do what is proper. I mean, we are not supposed to have tank farms in a purely residential area.
So we need the intervention of the federal government.
We need the intervention of the federal government. Mm. And also for Lagosians, I think the commissioners will hit the ground running to support the effort of the government.
Like you mentioned, Jide Idris, you said that's a capable hand, according to your words. That's someone that has experience.
Yeah, and like,
so we should be expecting what he's been doing before in the health sector.
Or even do more. And also, Mubireola that you just mentioned.
Mubireola,
he was in charge of
Lamata. And Lamata did well.
Lamata did very well. As a matter of fact, Lamata, I mean, the Abuja monorail had to consult Lamata to come and replicate what they are doing in Lagos in Abuja. So he already has a foreknowledge. I mean, he has an experience in terms of management of the transport system. But I think there was a time in Lagos too that we had this odd and even number. A lot of options that's not available anymore. Yeah, no, there are a lot of options should be explored to ensure that at least we reduce the number of vehicles plying our roads.
I just mentioned Jide Idris, and one is a star when it comes to, you know, that Ebola issue in Nigeria.
Yeah.
He fought Ebola stand still. Sure. Should we expect him more of that from him?
Yeah, definitely, because, you know, he's a tested professional. And just like other commissioners, like you mentioned, Mobirola, who is a transportation guru, one would expect that as time progresses, that Lagosians will continue to benefit from the dividend of democracy that we are already beneficiaries of. But, you know, like you, as we know human beings to be, we are Oliver Twist.
We want more. Yeah. Okay, the Minister of Environment, we have Babatunde Adejare, tested also.
Adejare is a tested hand, and you know, he has a fat back to lean on. I mean, in the SSG, who used to be the SSG Tunji Bello used to be the Commissioner for the Environment. Mm. So he can always run to a big brother. I mean, if he has a help, but I think. Basically, the Ministry of Environment will continue to excel. Adejare is a tested and trusted, and I want to believe it will deliver, especially in terms of the drain drugs. Clearing the drainages and making the gardens very beautiful, I mean, attractive for Lagosians to use as a leisure.
What's your own take on Loma so far? Do you think Loma have tried talking about environment?
Loma is still up and doing, because you can observe that daily you see them clearing the roads, you see them taking away refuses, you see them clearing the drains and what have you. So far, so good. I think, like we have highlighted there, it has been a continuity of the standard of excellence that has been set by the predecessors. And one can only hope that this template will be taken further than this.
And as Oliver Twist, we will still want
more. We'll see one more. Yeah.
So you think Adejare can do more about cleaning Lagos?
I'm very, very optimistic, because of the fact that once you know that your captain is a capable hand, you have no choice than, you know, to follow in the footsteps of your captain. And, you know, when we're talking about the captain, we're talking about the governor, who we know is a tested and trusted technocrat par excellence.
Okay.
So we expect that the commissioners and the special advisors know what is expected of them. From the people of Lagos.
Sorry, why still on the environment? I mean, you can see that there's a PPP initiative, private partnership initiative on the clearing of refuse. I mean, you see, we also have a role to play as Lagosians, as citizens, to ensure that we pay I think it's about 1,500 per month to those people. So you can see that. From one of the dirtiest cities in the world, Lagos has become, you hardly find heaps of refuse on the streets of Lagos any longer.
And what happened to that Olososon? Is it this waste to wealth?
Yeah.
And I heard we're going to be generating enough electricity from even waste.
Yeah, I think there's a plan to have that there. I think the study is going on using organic mold to generate clean electricity. It's a huge project, which I want to believe the administration of Ambode should take into consideration. And see how we can turn waste to wealth, and as in the real sense of it.
Okay, let's talk about education. You know, as the norm, you have the deputy governor in charge, Oluranti Adebule. So what are we expecting?
And you know, there's also a special advisor. I think it's Bankolima.
Fela
Bankolima, who is the special advisor. I mean, even the name alone, I mean, I was telling a friend of mine, I said, I like the sound of the name, Bankolima. Mm-hmm. Very, 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 very posh, you know. And you want to believe that the deputy governor, I mean, is somebody that, I mean, you see, has been in the academics and also a thoroughbred civil servant. Mm. She knows her onions, and I think she'll follow in the direction of what has been happening in the past.
Do you still have this free education?
There's free education in Lagos State. And I want to believe that we should, the public schools in Lagos, most of them are very good. And you know, you have this, there are some mega schools and
model,
there are some
model colleges.
Some model colleges, which are in the range of the federal government colleges.
Yeah.
Mm. I think we can have more, and to ensure that the public and the private schools get some challenge, like what we had in River State, where you don't really have to put your child in a private school, because the public schools in Lagos, in Rivers, built by Amishi, I mean, were very competitive and comfortable, very world class centers of study for primary and secondary schools.
Okay, I have to interrupt you to go to Abuja, where we have our correspondent Joke Adisa standing by. Good morning, Joke. What is happening today? Is the screening, has it started?
Yeah, good morning, Dapo. Yes, the plenary started like some 5-10 minutes ago, but the senators have now resolved to a closed door session. They are now in a closed door meeting as we speak.
Okay, so when should we expect the screening to start then?
Well, we are waiting. We are here waiting. We don't know how long that closed door meeting will go for, but we are hoping that it will not take much time, considering the fact that they have 6 names to take on today, as far as the ministerial screening is concerned. Top on that list is the name of the former River State Governor, Rotimi Amaechi, followed by former Senator Eneke Nwobiri, and 4 others. So we are hoping that this closed door meeting won't last long.
So we are expecting to see the former governor of River State screened today. Is that what you're saying?
Hello?
Said, are we expecting the former River Hello? State governor, Rotimi Amaechi, is he going to be screened today?
Yes. His name is the first name on the list of those to be screened today. And we have seen him, he has arrived. But some minutes ago, even before the plenary started, he was in a meeting with some senators, but they wouldn't allow anyone privy to that meeting. So we wouldn't know what they discussed. But now, we are very sure, we've seen him, he's very much on the ground, and that his name is first among those that will be screened today.
Okay. So thank you very much.
Let me also say this. By the time now, when you go through the constitution, in line with the constitution, section 147, subsection 6 of the 1999 constitution as amended, actually would confer on him the status of a minister, with or without the Senate's screening. Should the Senate continue to delay, by the time the submission before the Senate is 21 days, the nominee becomes automatically a minister. So I think the Senate is also in lieu of that information, and I'm sure that, of course, will be one of the reasons why they have to go on this closed-door meeting. And earlier that we spoke with one of the senators, Senator Andy Uba, he confirmed to us that the ad hoc committee has not submitted its report. And what that means is that Except that committee submits this morning or immediately after now, they won't be able to take on the former governor once again. And but if they delay further, by the time it is 21 days that the president has submitted the list to the Senate without screening, the nominee automatically becomes a minister. So we're looking at how the game will actually play out as soon as they come back from this closed-door session.
Okay. We're definitely waiting also. Thank you very much, Joke Adisa from the National Assembly. Amojid, let's quickly talk about that. 21 working days. Which one are we following? Because the Senate, I heard an argument of recent that the Senate working days is different from the normal working days that the Constitution, is it the Constitution or normally the normal working days?
The Constitution says, Section 147, as Dr. Adisa said. Section 1, no, we were discussing that before we started this program.
Yes.
The Constitution says 21 days. Now, the Senate might interpret to mean 21 days as in 5 working days in a week, or their own working days, which is 3 working days in a week. The Senate only sits 3 days a week. It's like when a judge commits somebody to prison and he says he's jailed 5 years.
5 years.
5 years to Nigerians is 5 years, as in 365 days times five. Mm. But then in prison terms, in judiciary terms, it's actually 22 or 20 days makes 1 month. So there are 5 years in the Gregorian calendar. It's like 3.5 years or 3 years in the prison calendar. So we don't know which working days the Senate will agree on. Probably after their meeting. Mm. I mean, which they normally do. But then you could recall that because of Amaechi, there was a caucus of the APC meeting which agreed that Amaechi will be given a clean bill of health.
Yes.
Which, I mean, they normally said that much. Mm. And after that, before they adjourned for sitting on Tuesday, PDP caucus in the Senate also went for a meeting, although we are yet to be briefed about the outcome of their meeting. But I want to believe that we are just counting down, whether it is 21 days, which actually elapsed yesterday because the names were submitted on September 30, or it's going to be the 5 working days per week, which will elapse next week. Like Joke said, they can't. So that's why we have checks and balances in the Nigerian constitution.
But you cited the example of former minister Aburishade.
Yes, yes, sorry, yeah. Babalola Aburishade. He had that privilege then. The Obasanjo just submitted his name, and there were issues from Ekiti State then. I mean, they were going back and forth until the 21 working days elapsed, and the man was not screened, and he was sworn in as a minister. So the proviso that allowed him to, take that privilege of the 21-day window provided by the Constitution was enacted, was used.
Nelson, what's your own take?
Oh, my own take on it is that it is becoming more of an abracadabra show. Because I remember vividly well when Amaechi appeared before the Ethics Committee, and we were told that it will amount to sub judice if they should look into the allegations because the case was in court. Only for us, the Senate themselves, the Ethics Committee even said it in the glare of the whole world, in the view of the whole world. Only for the Senate to be telling us weeks after that they are yet to receive the report. So it tells you that what do these people take us for? Abba, we are not kids. Mm. I think they are playing some games.
Now they still don't have the report.
Whether they will confirm him today or not. One thing we know very well, like what your correspondent rightly said, is that there's a 21 days window. And I was with a legal mind on a program yesterday, and he made us realize that what the Constitution says is that if after 21 days they don't transmit to the president, automatically
it becomes a
minister.
Can I quickly take Adam, our first caller? I think we lost our call. So what is going to happen now? What do you think is going to be screened today?
Well, I don't want to take a bet on that because on Tuesday, his name was listed.
We thought he was going to be screened.
I think the Senate is taking Nigerians for a ride. On Tuesday, after their closed-door meeting, the spokesperson for the Senate addressed Nigerians that going forward, they have just realized that they were too fast with those senators, and then they want to go into a very rigorous session with the ministerial nominees. So they said they are reducing the list from 8 to 3. So they took 3, and
eventually they took 2.
Olaide
is calling from Agodo. Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Dapo.
Good morning, sir.
Please, I first of all to ask about Mr. Yori. For a long time, I have not seen him.
He's been on holiday. He's going to be back next week, by God's grace. Yes.
And secondly, please, what is our National Assembly, which is senator? I don't know what they are doing there. According to what I hear for some people, this would be needed to cancel National Assembly before the next election because they have not do anything there. They are just playing, laughing, and fighting, and all this rubbish they are doing there. Please. There's just talk of this rubbish and the political rubbish they are doing there. So they're not fulfilled their promise to Nigeria. They're not doing nothing.
Okay.
So people to talk about it, they talk to them very well.
Okay,
so
thank you.
That's my opinion.
Thank you very much. Right. I hope they are listening because that's another dimension.
Honestly, a lot of Nigerians are even advocating the Senegalese methods, you know.
It sounds easy, but it's not easy.
We can start the process because honestly, look at what happened yesterday. Because of the trial of a member of the National Assembly, the Senate
shut down
the interests of 180 million people. Abba, it's unfair. It doesn't show responsibility and responsiveness. And ordinarily, these people were voted into office to go and make laws for the good of the Nigerian people.
Can I quickly take Honorable Segun Williams from Ikorodu? Good morning, Honorable.
My brother, good morning.
Morning.
Long time.
Long time indeed. Your contribution today.
My brother, Daniel Saka, and Nelson.
Good morning.
Amen.
Yeah. Anyway, what I want to say is, I know for sure that Governor Akin Oyambode surely performed very well. And he's one of the luckiest governor now. That is to say, you know, if he's not in control of Lagos State, and we have the Abuja as well.
Mm.
So we surely succeed, and we do well.
Okay.
But you know, there's one thing from Ikorodu here to my job into before now was terrible traffic. But for a couple of weeks now, those things are disappeared. Based on the action of the governor and people that are concerned.
Okay.
And I know you will surely perform and okay. You will do well.
Thank you very much, Segun Williams. Thank you very much. That's a good news, the traffic.
Definitely, yeah.
Yeah, Lasma is really back on the roads. And now, I think, you see, if you can recall, the governor went to the Lasma yard at Oshodi and ordered all the vehicles to be released. So people took that for granted. And what the governor meant was that Lasma should give an human face to whatever they are doing. So Lagosians took that for granted. And people now start attacking BRT lane that the governor has told last man not to arrest people again.
That
was the interpretation. But now, that's why I said, even we Lagosians, we have a role to play in assuring that we pay our own part of.
Who's going to pay this part of? Because we're still talking about the screening.
Yep.
But who's going to talk about? Who's going to pay the part of taking care of these bus drivers, the way they drive, the way they park on the road? I think most of the time around Ajota, that should be part of the traffic we see around.
Well, I think the state has a responsibility to rein them in, because honestly, if you drive on Lagos Road, if you are a first-time driver, I'm sure at the end of the day, you need to see
the
your physician.
Mm, yeah, the BP
because
will
the
rise.
Way they drive, it belittles our humanity as a people. And you know, the role of making the society orderly is not only that of the government. Even the Bible says it. Order, even in heaven, there's orderliness. No society can progress or prosper in chaos. And that is what we are witnessing. So it builds on you and I. As we are shouting the mantra change, in what way have you played your part, in being a responsible and orderly citizen? So it is important for Nigerians themselves and Lagosians to realize that we all have a part to play. The governor can, if there's a traffic jam in Ikorodu, the governor cannot be in Ikorodu. The governor will probably be in his office attending to other state issues.
I have a Yakub from Dokpemu. Good morning. Oh, Yakub, please try and call back. I went to you immediately.
So, like I was saying, the indiscipline of our people, we need to talk to ourselves. Like if I'm in the bus, out, you see passengers wanting the driver to stop at places other than the designated.
No, they even prefer the drivers to drive on the lanes that are so dangerous, just because they want to get to where
they don't even value their lives.
And when you talk to the drivers, they tell you, "God, Benu song."
No, the one.
Why that?
No, one other thing is, like I said, Nigerians. I mean, not Lagosians per se. Nigerians generally will go abroad. Will be traffic lights. Like he said, people jump the red lights. And you see, ask some of these drivers, they don't know the difference between dotted lines and straight lines.
Yes, that, I don't. They don't.
Yeah, dotted lines, you can cross lanes, but straight lines, you cannot. But then you see them maneuvering, the, I mean, driving recklessly. Because and even
can I quickly take this call from Zamfara? Yeah. I don't want to. Shuaibu Muhammad, good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, just continue. There's a delay. Just continue, please.
How is work, sir?
Very good, but you need to kill the audio on your TV also.
All right, sir. I would like to give my on the program going on now. The Senate, we hope that they will confirm the nominee, Rotimi Amaechi, today, because many of us are to see that Rotimi Amaechi is confirmed today as a minister of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. So we have confidence in the Senate to confirm the Honorable Rotimi Amaechi as a minister of the Federal Republic of Nigeria.
Okay.
So all other ones are also hoping that they will confirm them so that they will enable President Muhammad Buhari start his try to achieve the agenda or the manifestos of the APC.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mohammed. Mohammed has taken us to the screening again. But I think even from Zamfara, they want Amaechi screened. So who is it that does? Is it the petitioners or who is it that doesn't really want Amaechi screened?
Well, I wouldn't know. But I know very well that the Constitution stipulates that the National Assembly is a lawmaking institution. That the National Assembly is not an adjudicating institution or a court of law. So even if allegations or petitions have been raised against Mr. Rotimi Amaechi, it behoves on the National Assembly not to usurp the responsibilities of the security agencies and the courts. It because they don't have the wherewithal, they don't have the constitutional powers to even investigate. They don't have the training. That is the responsibility of the security agencies. And the security agencies are established by law, just like the National Assembly. One would expect that they will continue to remain responsible by ensuring that they don't take over a function that is not statutorily theirs.
Okay, and I have Serikinda Kabiru from Niger State. Good morning. Which one will I use, Kabiru or Serikinda?
Yes, Kabiru.
Okay, good morning. Your contribution, please.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yes, I also contribute to the Minister's screen. Honestly, most of these senators, honestly, they are not representing the interests of Nigerians. They are representing their selfish interests because they are playing politics with the national issues. They are supposed to screen all these ministers, not only the deal of Rotimi Amaechi and for him to be confirmed, simply because of the enmity between most of those are PDP senators having for him, and they refused, which means they are putting their own personal interest beyond the national interest, and which is not supposed to be.
Okay. Thank you very much, Kabir. Some people are saying, Majid, is it possible? Some people are saying, with the way things are going, we might not even have ministers this year.
Well, like the callers have been saying, I think the National Assembly or the senators are taking Nigerians for a ride. And I think it's high time we did something about them. Probably Nigerians should carry placards because look at what happened on Tuesday, for example. The screening after Shitu's the nominee from Oyo State, after his screening, then they called Khadija, the nominee from I think he's from Yobe State. And I've never seen anything that is more absurd. Now, the woman got there, the nominee Khadija presented a CV. The Senate president took over and said she's going to throw a question. I mean, that she will allow two people to ask questions, but that the first person will ask the question with the follow-up question will depend on how she answers the first one.
Yeah.
Lo and behold, the husband is also a sitting senator, a former governor.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the Senate president called on the husband, and the husband was asking, you are a three-time member of the House of Reps serving. You are the only person that didn't have any case at the tribunal for the three times.
Would you just say it? I need to take a bill for Bida. Our last caller for today. Good morning.
Hello.
Yeah, good morning. Briefly, we're rounding up now. Your contribution, please.
Good morning.
Bello, your contribution, please. We're rounding up. I think the network is not that friendly. Yeah. Gentlemen, we're running some seconds to go. Your conclusion.
Well, my conclusion is that I think I want to use this medium to commend the governor of Lagos State, Mr. Kinwumi Ambode, for that wonderful gesture he exhibited at the Council of States meeting, where he fulfilled one of the conditions for, you know, humanity, that we should be our brother's keeper by donating to the internally displaced people.
Yes, that's true.
Those three states. For me, it was a commendable gesture, and we must encourage ourselves that the only way we can help our society if we start acting toward the holy books is that we should love
your neighbor,
our neighbor
as ourselves. 150 million naira was distributed between three states. That's a lovely one. Okay, we're leaving now. Majid, I don't have time to take you again. I want to say thank you very much, Majid Jamiu, and also Nelson Ekujimi, rights activist. I thank you very much for being part of the program. I am Dakmo Aruwaje. I want to say bye for now, and God bless Nigeria.